Good afternoon. I'm not totally a stranger to this Santa Barbara area. In fact, I lived for a year just off the campus on Moore Mesa 20 years ago, 1972, when I was commuting to Ventura as a deputy district attorney prosecuting criminal cases. People still remember that as a time when crime was lowered enormously throughout the region. On weekends, I would be up here, of course, at home, and I used to go bicycling through the campus, and one of the things that I remember was that on weekends, there weren't a lot of people on the campus, partly because there's so many other wonderful things to do. So I had a feeling that it would not be an absolutely packed house on a beautiful Sunday afternoon in Santa Barbara, but I'm very glad to see all of you who were able to come out. As you know, I am a sometime criminal lawyer and a professor of law, especially criminal law, at the University of California. When I teach my students about criminal law and police procedure, I try to give them a feeling for the ways that different actors in the system think. So that I talk about judge think, and I talk about cop think, and I talk about suspect think. You know, so that if you have a situation, for example, that there's a suitcase, let's say, and a dog that is trained to spot drugs has alerted to the presence of drugs in this suitcase, a judge think would be, ah, yes, the officer should now go and find a judicial officer and get a search warrant to search that suitcase. Whereas, of course, a policeman will think, oh, what a lot of bother, who would want to do that? Let's see if there's some other way we can do that without going through all of this trouble, so that they naturally have their own viewpoint on the situation because of the different roles that they play in the system. So what I thought I might do in this lecture is tell you something about different kinds of thinking that's going on about Darwinian evolution, some of it in response to my book, which is, I'm glad to say, still getting some reviews month by month. I think there were three last month, even though it's almost 2 years since it's been out. Most of the reviews are pretty critical, I must say, but I'm glad to be getting the attention anyway. And it's given me a lot of opportunity to examine the thinking of other people who deal with these scientific and philosophical subjects. So I'm going to tell you about skeptic think, that is, skeptics with regard to Darwinism. That's like me. I'll tell you something about scientific reductionist think. I'll tell you something about philosopher of science think, to give you a sense of the way that different people are coming to grips with the problems that have been identified with the reigning scientific paradigm that tells us how we got to be here. Now, first, an introduction to my own views. This is skeptic think. I'm a skeptical about the Darwinian theory of evolution, the paradigm that dominates biological science in our time. Now, what does that mean, and what is one skeptical about? Well, the first thing that this skeptic does is to identify the issue. What is the question that's important? What is it we need to think about? And in that case, there are some things that aren't very important. For example, somebody will say, well, does evolution occur? Well, that depends what you mean by evolution. One of the most prominent examples of evolution in action that all of the books cite is the breeding of domestic animals or of selective breeding of plants. So you have dog breeding, for example, that gets us all these Chihuahuas and Great Danes and whatever. And people will say, well, that's evolution. Well, that certainly does happen. We do have these breed of dogs. Dog breeding does occur. And it's certainly also the case that there's a degree of variation that occurs in plants and animals. If, for example, a couple of birds migrate to an offshore island and there become isolated and inbreed for generations, there will be a degree of variation that will occur. The processes of migration, inbreeding, mutation, genetic drift, natural selection will produce varieties or even new species of birds which are somewhat different from the mainland population of a similar bird. So Evolution in this sense is not really an issue. It's an observable process. It's an easily inferable process, and it's no big a problem. The question that a skeptic is interested in is the big question. How do you get birds in the first place? The most famous example of evolution in action that is cited in all the books, that is the most famous proof of the process of Darwinian evolution by natural selection, is the case of the peppered moth in the Midlands of England. During a period of time, there was a population of moths which had predominantly light-colored moths in the population, a minority of dark-colored moths. But when the trees were darkened by industrial smoke, the number of dark moths rose and the number of light moths, relatively speaking, declined. So that for a time you had more dark moths and fewer light moths. And then when the trees became light-colored again, due to cleaning up of the air by air pollution laws, the birds could see the dark moths against the light trees better, ate them with abandon, and you had a return to the pre-existing population. A variation in the number of light and dark moths. There were light and dark moths throughout the period of time. Nothing new appeared. Nothing was created. That's uncontroversial. What the skeptic wants to know is, how do you get moths and trees and birds and scientific observers in the first place? And that's the question that we want to know. How do you start with a simple bacterial cell? Over a period of time, as the theory claims it has happened, you get a complex plants and animals. Through the operation of nothing but purposeless, material, natural processes. That's what's supposed to happen. What the skeptic wants to know is that true? Do we know how such a thing can happen? Did it happen as the Darwinian theory says it must have happened, through a combination of random genetic changes, mutations, recombination, whatever, random genetic changes, plus the sifting, selecting force of natural selection, which is the brute fact that some creatures are better at surviving and reproducing than others, and therefore leave more offspring than others, and therefore come to dominate the population. So that's the question the skeptic wants answered. And how did all of this come about in the first place? How do we get from very simple things to very complicated living things, eventually to ourselves? Indeed, how do we get life started in the first place? Now, in order to focus on that question, this skeptic has found that it's almost essential to adopt a new vocabulary. And the reason is that the old vocabulary is calculated to divert attention from the main issue. Because the old vocabulary speaks of evolution. And evolution turns out to mean just about everything except the strictest form of six-day young earth biblical a fundamentalist special creation. Evolution means dog breeding. Evolution means the variations in the shapes of the beaks of finches on the Galapagos Islands, the variation that occurred, as I've indicated, following migration from the mainland. One eminent professor of my acquaintance told me that I must be completely wrong. The theory of evolution must be true, because there are flightless birds on Hawaii. He said those birds obviously migrated from a mainland somewhere, and due to inbreeding in Hawaii, they lost the ability to fly, and yet nonetheless they survived until predators were introduced to the islands in the 19th century following their discovery by European explorers. Then the flightless birds became extinct. Well, isn't that evolution? Well, of course it is. But what we want to know is not how a bird which was able to fly could become so degenerate as to lose that ability, but rather how birds got the ability to fly in the first place. Now they became birds. So the word evolution inherently distracts attention from the main question. If you say, I want to know how you got birds in the first place, somebody will say, well, the answer is evolution, and look at that breeding that's done. Look at those variations that appear. That's evolution. Therefore, that's the answer. Evolution means everything from the smallest variations to the grand creation story of how we got complex plants and animals in the first place. So what I do to try to put attention on the main point is to put aside that misleading word evolution and to speak of what I call the blind watchmaker thesis. Now, the blind watchmaker thesis comes from the title of a book by Richard Dawkins, the eminent Oxford University zoologist. And Richard Dawkins tells us at the beginning of that book that living things appear to be extremely complex entities which look as if they were designed by an intelligent creator for a purpose. That is to say, that they look as if they were created by a supernatural being. But, says Richard Dawkins, they were not, because we know that the forces of random genetic change and natural selection, purely unintelligent material forces, were in fact capable of doing all of this creating and did do it. That's the blind watchmaker thesis, the thesis that random genetic change and natural selection, rather than pre-existing intelligence and purpose, is behind the existence of all of the extremely complex plant and animal beings, including ourselves, which now populate the planet. Now, it's that thesis, the blind watchmaker thesis, that the skeptic wants to look at, because that's the important thesis. That's what really matters to people. It doesn't have tremendous importance outside of the scientific classroom or laboratory itself, whether you can get a degree of variation in created things which already exist. It's significant that we can breed dogs to get varieties which are particularly good hunters or show dogs or whatever. That's important for people who love dogs. It's important that we can get varieties of orchids. That's important for people who love varieties of flowers. But it isn't of enormous philosophical importance. What's of enormous philosophical and religious importance to us is the question, are we here because a purposeful, intelligent being brought about our existence, or are we here because of the operation of material forces that have no intelligence and have no purpose and inherently can care nothing about us? Biological science, in the form of the Darwinian theory, purports to have answered that question. So is the blind watchmaker thesis true? Now, this is the question that the skeptic wants to ask. Now, the skeptic will again find a great deal of difficulty in asking that question. I've told you of one form of difficulty that will be presented. The skeptic will be told, we have enormous evidence of evolution. The subject will be changed, you see, to provide something simple, something minor, which can be proved. That will be called evolution, and evolution is the answer to how we all came into existence too, and so there's an end of it. Well, we'll put that aside. We've already seen that the word evolution can't be used as an all-purpose answer to the question, how did we get here? Another problem that the skeptic will immediately encounter, however, is that the skeptic will be told, the answer to your question is in the province of science. Science is committed to philosophical naturalism, and therefore, science must assume that no creator and no purposeful intelligence is behind our existence. And that's an end to it. Now, that is to say, by this means, an important question has been transformed into a non-question. The skeptic wants to ask, is it true what certain scientists tell us, that we are here as a result of purposeless natural forces rather than an intelligent creator? And the skeptic will be answered, science is so defined that that must be the answer. The only question that science can address is not whether there is a purposeless means of creation, because purpose could come into existence only when it had evolved by purposeless means. All that science can address is the question of, granted that we are here as a result of purposeless material mechanisms, what's the most plausible purposeless material mechanism that we can imagine? And in that case, the answer will be the force that produced those variations in the population of light and dark peppered moths. Because that's what we can observe happening. It must be the same sort of thing writ large that produced moths and trees and scientific observers in the first place. And if the skeptic says, well, I'm not satisfied, I want to know, how do you know that? The answer will be, what is your alternative? We have given you a scientific answer. It is an answer which is scientific because it rests only on things that we can observe, extending their effects enormously, to be sure, but at least we can observe them doing a little bit. And if you don't like that answer, what better answer can you provide? You cannot answer that question by saying, I believe that a creator did the creating, because the skeptic will be told, that's a subject outside of science. We've already told you how we define science. Weren't you listening? We told you that science assumes that we are here as a result of purposeless material processes. So that is strike one. And if you say, well, how about the answer, we don't know, the skeptic will be told, that isn't acceptable under the rules of science either. You don't know how science works, because we have given you a scientific answer. If you don't like the answer, you're free to try to improve on it, but science does not operate by discarding what is already known and going right back to the beginning and saying, we don't know anything, we give up. We're going to turn it over to the priests or the metaphysicians or the television commentators or something like that. Science stays with the answer it has, and no matter how many difficulties that answer is encountering, until or unless a better answer, which is fully naturalistic, and involves no creator, supernatural power, or whatever, is produced. So the skeptic finds that in the attempt to ask the critical question, is the blind watchmaker thesis true, he has been met with a series of philosophical barricades that make that question practically impossible to ask in a university or scientific forum. Now, what conclusion does the skeptic come to from all of this encounter? Of course, what I'm describing to you is the encounter that I have had over the years with my many colleagues and debating adversaries and whatnot who have come from the camp of Darwinian belief. Well, it seems to the skeptic to be fairly clear what has happened. That what has happened is this. Is that science of a certain kind desperately wants to answer from its own resources the question, how did we come to be here? In order to answer that question, it has to make certain very far-reaching and controversial assumptions, and then to protect those assumptions. And what has happened is this, that in the 19th century, a scientist became aware of a way in which they could explain how certain small-scale changes occur in beings which are already in existence. This was the original version of the Darwinian theory of evolution. Charles Darwin advanced this theory to challenge the position that he stated as the alternative, that the species are immutable. That is, that every species today is exactly the way it has always been in the past. Now, he was able to show with some success, with a great deal of success, that that straw man proposition is not true. That is to say that there has been variation and change in the kinds of living creatures that exist, that they have changed somewhat, just as those island species change over time, that they are modified somewhat from what they were before. Moreover, a science was able to show, and quite convincingly, that there are different kinds of beings have lived on the Earth at different times. The fossils record many species, many types of creatures, such as the dinosaurs, that existed in the past and that do not exist today. Some of the creatures that exist today appear only late in the geological column, or relatively later than other creatures. So there seems to have been some change in the kinds of living things that lived on the Earth at different times. Armed with that information, an adventurous band of scientists said, well, why don't we posit that the same force that produces these minor changes that shows change in the species could be responsible for all of the work of creation, from the very simplest first being all the way to the present, and treat that as our starting point for further research, and accept that as an explanation for everything that has happened. And the explanation was so satisfying to the scientific mind. It was so, it seemed to explain so much if it were true, that it became very dear and very cherished. And indeed, it changed the world. It enabled the scientists to become the most important cultural authorities of their society, replacing the clergy, it had enormous consequences for the way people came to see themselves, and eventually it became to be a fundamental truth and doctrine to be cherished and protected, rather than a mere hypothesis to be tested against the evidence. By this process of extrapolation, a solution to a very minor part of the history of life became accepted and protected as the story of all creation. And even now, when it is clear to a great many skeptics within the scientific world that the evidence does not support the claim that life evolved in a series of tiny step by tiny step increments, as the theory says, the theory has been protected by that all-purpose philosophical response, what is your alternative? Now, that's the way the skeptic thinks. And as some of you probably know from having read the book, perhaps from having read some of the many reviews that have been come about, there's been a tremendous amount of debate about all of those propositions in the skeptical case. Most of that debate has centered upon the philosophical issues rather than on the accuracy of any particular piece of scientific information. There is no great mystery in my mind as to why that is the case. There is, in fact, so much information which is tremendously difficult to reconcile with the Darwinian paradigm that many of the most eminent authorities who have supported that paradigm from time to time have, in fact, acknowledged the existence of a fossil record, for example, which is tremendously difficult to reconcile with Darwinian expectations. My formidable adversary, Stephen Jay Gould, even described in one of his papers the Darwinian theory as effectively dead, and then came back later to defend it, precisely because he realized that there was no alternative, and that to abandon the Darwinian theory was to abandon for the moment the claim that science has solved the mystery of how we got here. But there's been a tremendous amount of controversy over the book, and now that I've given you a picture of the skeptic think, I want to tell you about how a couple of very prominent critics have reacted to the skeptic's argument and to the argument of the book. One of those critics is not a biologist, it's a great physicist, Steven Weinberg. the Nobel Prize-winning physicist, who is the principal author of the electroweak theory, which is a first step towards the dream of a grand unified theory that will unite all of the forces of physics into a grand synthesis and be the greatest scientific accomplishment of all time. This is the dream which is discussed in a book that probably many of you have seen, either the book or the movie that was made of the book, Stephen Hawking's A Brief History of Time. It's been the subject of many other books with titles like The Theory of Everything, The Mind of God, The God Particle, or in Steven Weinberg's case, Dreams of a Final Theory. I bring a physicist into this to show you how, because I think it's tremendously instructive, to show you how a great scientific intellect and one of the real rulers of science of our time looks at the challenge to the Darwinian paradigm from his perspective. Because Weinberg has just come out with a book for the general reader, quite a good book, called Dreams of a Final Theory, and he does me the honor of taking several pages in the book's next to last chapter to discuss my challenge to Darwinism. In fact, he does me the honor to call me the most respectable academic critic of evolution today, a title which I would take great pride in if I were not aware that Professor Weinberg has an extremely low opinion of all of the other critics of evolution. So that it's a little bit like being the sanest person in the insane asylum, or the most honest man in state prison, or something like that. But I'll take these honors where I can get them without looking too carefully at the implications. One of the interesting things about Professor Weinberg's critique of Johnson's critique of the Neo-Darwinian synthesis is that he was able to refute me without ever once looking at the book. That is to say, as far as one can tell from the book itself and the reference notes to it, he relied entirely on an article I had written for First Things magazine. And had not bothered to look up the evidence in the book. He tells me that he has since looked at it, and when we had a discussion of this in Texas, but that doesn't appear from the book. And he didn't have to, in part because he is a particle physicist and so far above biologists in standing, that he doesn't really need to look at the details of the evidence, but mainly because it is a... He can tell that I must be wrong because I do not think as the scientific enterprise requires one to think. And that's really the point I want to emphasize to you today, as I describe to you how a physicist who is a scientific reductionist reacts to a criticism of Darwinian theory. And his response is essentially to say, so Johnson has shown that the Neo-Darwinian theory is against the evidence at various points. So what? Essentially, the answer is so what? He says, in making that point, Johnson simply shows that he doesn't understand how science works, a complaint that I am very used to hearing, I assure you. And specifically, he says, Johnson has no feeling for the problems that any scientific theory has in accounting for what we observe. There never was a time when the calculations based on Newton's theory of gravitation or any other theory were in perfect agreement with all observations. In the writings of today's paleontologists and evolutionary biologists, we can recognize the same state of affairs that is familiar to us in physics. In using the naturalistic theory of evolution, biologists are working with an overwhelmingly successful theory, but one that is not yet finished with its work of explication. It seems to me to be a profoundly important discovery that we can get very far in explaining the world without invoking divine intervention, and in biology as well as in the physical sciences. Now, that is to say that the refutation of my claim that the Darwinian theory is strongly against the evidence, when the evidence is considered objectively and without a bias in favor of the theory, is to say Lots of scientific theories have problems, but look at how successful we are. Why, for example, look at how successful the Darwinian theory has been. The theory itself is one of the great accomplishments of science, which he cites to show how successful it is and therefore how wrong the critic must be. Now, the reason for this is because the Darwinian evolutionary biology is part of a vast scientific reductionist program to which Weinberg's own work belongs. This is what I call, and he calls, the reductionist project. According to scientific reductionism, human mental life, our consciousness, our intelligence, our purposes, can be explained entirely in terms of the forces involved in chemistry. As one great biochemist, Stanford's Arthur Kornberg, put it, he was absolutely astonished to find that many otherwise intelligent people have not yet learned that the mind, as a part of life, is chemistry and only chemistry. You see, mental processes are fully explainable in terms of the chemistry of the brain. Similarly, according to reductionism, the life processes are fully explainable in terms of physics and chemistry. That is to say, there's nothing else except the laws of physics and chemistry that are involved in the origin of life and its maintenance today. And the principles of chemistry at a more complex level are explainable in terms of the law of physics. And finally, everything comes down to the moment at the earliest instance of the Big Bang when only the particles and the theory which governed their interactions existed. You see, at that point, at the earliest moment in the history of the universe, when everything was compressed into a single point, nothing existed except particles, forces, and the theory that governs them, and the vast explosion of energy that followed. Why didn't anything else exist? Well, what else could have existed? According to Professor Weinberg, the only way that any sort of science can proceed is to assume that there is no divine intervention and to see how far one can get with that assumption. That is, the way science proceeds is to assume that nothing exists except material forces, energy, and the relations between those forces, the energy and the material particles. Matter, energy, the void, is all that exists. There's no pre-existing purpose, no mind behind everything, or whatever. Now, you see, starting with that standpoint, it follows as a matter of elementary logic that everything exists today had its origin in the initial conditions at the beginning of the Big Bang. That the vast explosion of energy and then matter and that follows that is responsible for the existence of galaxies and stars, even though no one knows how galaxies were formed, and that the interactions of matter on the resulting planets, particularly on Earth, were responsible for life arising without any purpose being behind it, that life became more complex on its own steam, and that life generated, once it had gotten started, generated consciousness and intelligence. To deny that this is the true story of the entire history of the cosmos is to suggest that something else entered at some point from outside. And to suggest that that could be the case, says Professor Weinberg, would be to repudiate science. You see, it would be to repudiate the whole scientific enterprise. And so that is why a critique of a particular part of that enterprise, such as the Neo-Darwinian paradigm, is of no particular interest. Something very much like Neo-Darwinian evolution has to have occurred in any case, because there is no alternative within the reductionist view of the history of the cosmos. If it didn't happen exactly as Darwin imagined it, it must have happened in some other way that likewise involves nothing but purposeless material forces, because until life evolved and became complex enough to have intelligence and purpose, there was no intelligence and purpose around to have any effect on the outcome of physical processes. And so criticism of a particular plank in the reductionist platform is beside the point. Something very much like that must have happened anyway. And if indeed the theories run stark into what seems to be disconfirming evidence, that simply shows that they are incomplete. Because, after all, in many areas of science, there's great difficulty in accounting for the facts. The theories seem not to explain all the facts. That's a reason to look for better theories, but never a reason to discard the scientific program, which in its broadest sweep is the reductionist program. Persons who are trying to explain how memories can be stored in the brain, how conscious life can be produced just by chemicals in the brain, face many difficulties. But they don't doubt that the process can be carried out. Otherwise, their work would be hopeless. Persons who are trying to explain how life arose may find that their experiments all end in futility, that they're forced to work, as indeed they are now, with distinct theories that are mutually contradictory. And they seem to be getting nowhere. No matter, life must have arisen by purposeless chemical evolution because there is no alternative. And after all, Darwin explained in principle back in 1859 how you can get once you get life jump-started, as it were, started in any way, you can carry it all the way on up to complex plants and animals and human beings. And if anyone wants to say that that's not true, well, they must be wrong, because it's the only thing that could have happened. Now, I'm using this example of the program of reductionist science and the way that the critique of Darwinism that the skeptic has made can be answered without ever really looking at the details of the evidence, to raise the question, is what we have here an argument about the facts, or is it an argument about a basic philosophical outlook by which the facts are to be determined? It would seem to me, having studied Professor Weinberg's critique and having discussed it with him personally, and the similar critiques of many other people from mainstream science, that in a sense, we almost aren't in disagreement about anything scientific. Leading evolutionary authorities like Stephen Jay Gould, David Raup, and a number of others will indicate that, in fact, there's a vast amount of mystery about how large-scale evolution could have occurred. That is to say, they will indicate this when they feel secure that they can indicate it. As I've said, Professor Gould at other times has gone back to insist that there isn't any problem when he feels under attack. But the problem is that is simply that attack, there seems to be no doubt that there are many holes in the theory, but there's a philosophical sense that says something like this must be true anyway. Give us something that's better and we'll believe that. Until that, we'll stick with what we have. This seems to be a philosophical difference rather than a difference in scientific knowledge, a difference in the kind of answer that one will accept, indeed a difference in whether we're willing to accept an answer that we don't know things. And indeed with Professor Weinberg, the disagreement that he had with me certainly didn't have to do with anything in the facts of evolution. In fact, he showed a complete indifference to the details of the arguments over the facts. It was simply that purposeless materialistic evolution, the blind watchmaker thesis as I have called it, is an essential assumption that the scientific reductionist project must make if it is to pursue its goal of explaining all of the history of the cosmos and all of life and all of everything that has happened in the history of the cosmos in purely naturalistic terms, that is to say, without allowing any role to a creator or God. If one is going to try to do that, one must make certain assumptions. Well, I agree with that, but why do we have to make those assumptions, and why do we have to pursue that project? Well, that question now will bring me to the second critic of the skeptic's point of view that I'll mention, the philosopher of science and philosophy of science think. Because in addition to having had the honor of being criticized in Professor Weinberg's book, I had the honor this year of being the subject of a program at the American Association of the Advancement of Sciences, in which a speaker was the philosopher of science, Michael Ruse, a professor at a Canadian university, and the leading most influential expert witness for the evolutionist side in the famous Equal Time for Creationism trial in Arkansas in 1981, where the Darwinists and the creationists had their biggest battle in court. Ruth had debated me at Southern Methodist University in a program that was put together involving a number of people on my book in the spring of last year, 1992, and we'd had considerable interaction at that time. Well, as I say, in 1993, February, Roos was invited to do a program on me at the annual meeting of the American Association for the Advancement of Science. Now, I was not invited to this program. With respect to the AAAS, I am in the status not so much of a scientific examiner as a laboratory animal, I think, a subject of experiment and comment, but not one who is invited to participate in it. But friends of mine were at the gathering. The gathering was tape recorded for sales. It wasn't anything that was at all private, and I received a transcript of the entire thing within hours. And it was fascinating, because Professor Roos at this gathering said, engaged in some of the ritual Johnson bashing that was expected of him, but then very shortly into the program, he changed direction enormously. And he told the gathering that, in the first place, that he had had a very interesting time at the debate at Southern Methodist University with me and the other persons there who were participating, and that he had found that while it was easy to hate creationists in the abstract, as he calls everyone who dissents from the purely naturalistic and paradigm of Darwinism, he found it hard to dislike us in person, that we seemed almost disconcertingly friendly and fair in debate. And that, in fact, the subject of the debate was the question that I've just put really at the end of my discussion of Professor Weinberg. It was the question about the role of metaphysical naturalism in sustaining the Darwinist paradigm. That is to say, the question which was put and which we debated for 3 days at Southern Methodist was, is a belief, a pre-existing belief in metaphysical naturalism, a necessary component of the Darwinian evolutionary theory? I can put that in slightly different language that may make the issue a little bit easier for some of you to understand. You might say, if we agree that there is no God, then we agree, don't we, that nature had to have the resources to do its own creating, because there wasn't anything else. And if you make that starting point assumption, you'll agree that, well, something very much like the Darwinian theory of evolution must be true, as it's sort of the best guess anybody can make about how you can do all that creating without a creator. But suppose that you're a person who isn't willing to make that assumption. That's the assumption of metaphysical naturalism. Nothing but nature exists. Suppose you think that there is a creator, there is a God, or at least that there might be one. In that case, do you have any good reason to believe that a creator would necessarily have proceeded on the basis of an accumulation of random genetic changes through natural selection? And the answer that I made and a number of us made was no. The evidence doesn't support that things happened that way once you allow an alternative to the blind watchmaker thesis to come under consideration. What Ruth said almost a year later in Boston at the AAAS convention was, after having thought the matter over, he thought that he'd been perhaps rather naive at an earlier period in his life when he thought that the only reasonable thing to do was to accept the Darwinian theory as factual, that now he was inclined to agree that it involved an essential metaphysical component, naturalism. Essentially, that our side was correct in that debate, and that you had to be committed to metaphysical naturalism to find Darwinian evolution convincing. I'm told that when he finished his remarks and finished saying this, there was a stunned silence at the meeting. And I know that his remarks were greeted with great shock, because I recently read an account of this meeting It was one, you know, a whole morning session at which a number of people spoke on related topics. Bruce was the most noted speaker of the group, but not the only one on the program. An account of the entire program was published in the Times Educational Supplement of the London Times just last week. It's a very lengthy account, and it describes in detail what which was said by each one of the speakers. And it doesn't have a single word about Roos's lecture or that he appeared. And in light of the fact that he is by far the most prominent person who appeared there, and also the only Englishman at an American gathering, he's an Englishman who's teaching at a Canadian university, the fact that he disappeared entirely from history has a decidedly Orwellian flavor to it. And I can't wait to hear from Michael what he thinks about this when I bring it to his attention. Now, so essentially, I want to give Roos credit. Essentially, what he was doing is owning up to an intellectual problem that I think he's absolutely right about. That is, that the confidence that Darwinian evolution is the answer for how we got here is a deduction that one arrives at from the platform of metaphysical naturalism. If there is no creator, then something like that must have happened. But if one does not make that conclusive presumption, then it seems rather more that what the Darwinian theory is the best guess that has been able to be made by a scientific community which is very eager to provide an answer to the question of how we got here, an answer that excludes a God, and very anxious to hold on to that answer, but an answer which in fact is in conflict with the evidence at so many points that there's no reason for most of us to believe that it's true. Now, I've given you the skeptic think, and I've given you the reductionist think, and I've given you the philosopher of science think on this. Let me conclude by answering briefly the question, what should we make all of this? So how is this important to us, and what does all this mean to most of us? Well, I might start with a quotation from one of my Berkeley colleagues, a famous philosopher of science named Paul Feyerabend, something of a radical in that profession, who remarked once, he said, "Scientists are not content with running their own playpens in accordance with what they regard as the rules of the scientific method. They want to universalize those rules. They want them to become part of society at large. And they use every means at their disposal, argument, propaganda, pressure tactics, intimidation, lobbying, to achieve their aims." Now, that might sound rather aggressive and even rather cynical, but point of fact, what Professor Feyerabend was saying was that one of the things that is going on with the scientific community is an attempt to impose their metaphysics on the society at large, because they believe that it's a very good way for people to think. Professor Weinberg is very explicit about this. So is Professor Roos, by the way. So is Professor Gould. So are many others. That is to say, Professor Weinberg writes in his book, in discussing why it's so important to educate people about science, that he hopes that they will come to an understanding that the world is run by impersonal forces, that we are here as a result of impersonal material forces that care nothing about us, and that this will get rid of religion, which he regards as equivalent to superstition, and we'll all be better off. This will make humanity at least more rational than it is, if not completely rational. Now, that's an interesting proposition. And what it shows, I think, is that the program of science, of the kind of science that aspires to tell us the history of the cosmos, is a program that all of us have a stake in. Because it's tremendous importance to us to know the correct answer to questions like, are we here as a result of the action of a creator? Or are we here as a result of material purposeless processes? We want to know the true answer, not to shield ourselves in some kind of an illusion. But we don't want to be misled by scientific authorities who want us to believe one answer to that and who shape their evidence so that it can only support that answer. I think we want to know should want to know whether, in fact, the evidence of science fairly evaluated supports this reductionist naturalistic program. It seems to me that it does not. In fact, it's a faith which is in search of confirmation and which, because of that, has been greatly misleading to people who think they are hearing the objective voice of science. Now, it's tremendously important, then, that we be able to ask questions, that we be able to challenge the reigning philosophical points of view that authorities like Michael Ruse have agreed are there, philosophical assumptions that some of us might not share, might not want to make. But one of the problems is there's an authoritarian aspect to a certain kind of scientific thinking. Professor Weinberg, for example, believes that it is no business of citizens to ask about the religious implications of science, even though he himself asks this in a chapter called What About God? And lays down this law. Time magazine comes out with a cover story in December of this year, the Christmas issue, asking the question, what does science tell us about God? And the answer it gives is plenty and more all the time. That we are to take our knowledge of ultimate issues of where we came from science, but according to many of the scientific authorities, we are not allowed to question the assumptions that generated those answers. Now, I think that this is a line that the scientific world will not be able to hold. I had been hoping that it would be a part of the outcome of my own work that open and fair and honest discussion of the metaphysical biases and assumptions of the Darwinian project, and now, as I see, of the reductionist scientific project at large, will become possible. And I see that that is beginning to happen. And as that becomes possible, it's going to be tremendously important that as many people as can do so in the universities, as many students among those who are here and others as can do so, learn to understand those questions and learn to understand what the philosophical assumptions are so that they can participate in that discussion. Because, you know, we're entering into a new century. We're entering into a time when many of the old answers are crumbling all over the world. We're entering into a time in which very new ways of thinking will be necessary to preserve civilization from certain anarchic and disruptive influences that are even now tearing it apart. And a new century will have new kinds of knowledge and new kinds of scientific thinking. There's no reason to assume that the dogmas that dominated the 20th century will necessarily and always dominate the future of science and the future of thinking. So we're in a very exciting time. I'm excited to be participating in opening up the issues, and I'm very glad that all of you came to discuss these subjects with me, and I'm looking forward to any of the questions that you want to ask now in the remaining time. But thank you very much. All right,
My question is about Stephen Hawking. I have heard he's quite ill, and I'd like you to just explain, you mentioned him very briefly, what his theories are relating to Professor Weinberg's theories and how he contradicts you or affirms what you have to say.
Mm-hmm. The question is about Stephen Hawking. Of course, he is very ill. That is, he has a degenerative disease, a so-called Lou Gehrig's disease, which has made him a complete invalid and will eventually kill him, but he's very courageously continued to practice his scientific profession with that enormous handicap, and I have a great respect for him personally. And I might add, if any of you get an opportunity to see the film of A Brief History of Time, it's really a wonderful human interest story that I could say a lot about as an exercise in filmmaking. But your question is about Hawking's theories. And I think Hawking is the most famous of a whole group of theoretical physicists, mathematicians, particle physicists, who have promoted the idea of the theory of everything, or what Steven Weinberg calls the final theory. It's really along the same lines as Weinberg's book, only I think Weinberg's book as a piece of science writing is much superior to Hawking's book, A Brief History of Time, which is one of the biggest selling books in the history of publishing. Now, Weinberg's book is a very good explanation of how particle physicists think and what their theory is. But in both cases, with Hawking as with Weinberg, the basic point of view is that the thing which is ultimately real, the thing which is at the bottom of reality when you get all the way down, is the theory. It's a kind of a new take on what we previously would have called scientific materialism, that would have said that matter is what is fundamentally real and alternative. To the minds of this new breed of physics, the laws of science are sort of more real than the particles. In fact, some of them think that the theory itself called the particles out of the void, that the particles came out of quantum physics, really, as owe their existence to its principles. And in any event, the ultimate theory is a theory which explains how all of the forces of physics operated at the earliest instant of the Big Bang. The four forces are the strong and the weak nuclear force, electromagnetism, and gravity, which are now, in our present-day world, governed by different principles and different laws, but the theory is that they were unified back at that earliest instant of the Big Bang. And at that time, the theory and the particles was all that there was. Everything else owes its being, you know, to those initial conditions. And so, in principle, you have a theory of everything when you have a grand unified theory of the four fundamental forces at the beginning of the Big Bang. Now, Hawking, of all of these writers, takes this the farthest into metaphysical territory, because he says at the end of A Brief History of Time, and this is repeated in the movie, that when we have this final theory, we will understand everything about how the universe operates in principle, even though, and unfortunately, the calculations are too difficult to do with any system having more than two or three electrons. So there's a huge gap between the importance of the unified theory in principle and its abilities in practice. We will then perhaps be able to answer intelligently the question, why does anything exist at all? And when we answer that, then we will, he says, we will know the mind of God. Now, Hawking is not a person who believes in a God as a being, a creator distinct from the universe. He's a scientific naturalist like the others. And so when he says we will know the mind of God, what he really means is we will become the mind of God. The people who understand this will attain God's omniscience, you see. That's what it means. Now, so how it relates to my view, well, this is the view which is carried out to its extreme logical conclusion, a view which is totally antithetical to theistic religion of any kind, to the notion that there is a creator, a God. Rather, you see, the notion is what is ultimately real is the project of science, of reductionist science, and its ultimate goal, the theory of everything. And that when we know that, we will then have, as I say, we will take on God's omniscience, and perhaps as we learn to apply the theory, reductionist science and its theories more completely, we may be able to take on God's powers of creation, you know, eternal life, because we'll be able to manipulate everything. We'll be able to take control of the forces of evolution and set that's the power of creation itself, the future history of the cosmos. And we may even be able to, Hawking doesn't himself make this point, but others in reductionist science do, we may be able to transfer our mental processes, you see, to computers. And then live on in a silicon environment rather than a environment indefinitely. So actually, as I say, I've given you a little bit more than what Hawking says, but that's the farthest reach of the project of reductionist science. Yeah.
My question is a lot simpler, Professor Johnson, and can be answered briefly, I'm sure. Towards the end of your talk, you indicated some optimistic feelings and that there was other people that were questioning also. I know, of course, about Michael Denton, whether in science or out of science. Could you give us just two or three names or books that
Of other books which are questioning? Well, you know, there isn't a tremendous amount which is questioning in the kind of sense in which I am doing it. We have Other books which are cited in the research notes to my own book, such as The Mystery of Life's Origin by Thaxton, Bradley, and Olson, that's cited in the research notes to Chapter 8. You've mentioned Michael Denton's Evolution, A Theory in Crisis. But I think that the project of really putting out a respectable and viable alternative to the scientific naturalist approach is very much in its infancy. What's encouraging me, the positive note that you detected, has to do more with the internal strains of the dominant way of thinking than with, you know, with the very little bit that's been accomplished in terms of producing something different. In some of the lectures I do, I have explained how Professor Weinberg's scientific rationalism and reductionism, this notion that everything could be reduced to the laws of physics and so on, is going on at the same time that in the universities, relativistic views of science have been taking hold. So that on the one hand, you have these physicists saying, we can understand how to explain everything in terms of our final theory. And you have the philosophers and historians of science saying, you know, now we can explain the activities of these particle physicists as if they were a kind of tribe who have their own rituals and their own language and who are playing this language game of their own. And in a way, these developments are related. That, you see, the view of rationality which is driving the particle physicists is that the only regularity, the only rationality to the universe is the mathematical precision of the laws that govern the movements of particles and of fundamental energies. Everything else, all of human life and values, you know, how we should live, how we should treat other people, that is consigned to the realm of pure subjectivity. It's outside of the realm of science altogether. It's just an accidental product of the forces set in motion by the final theory at the very beginning. And so you see, everything that really concerns human beings outside of particle physicists is left to pure subjectivity. Well, anyone who has anything to do with a modern university can see this working itself out. You have all of these, now everybody's got to have a separate department to advocate their own point of view. There's no intellectual common ground. You have a complete subjectivity and relativism in ethics and so on. And so that finally, science itself begins to be viewed as something of a subjective project. It's that realization that in part explains why Michael Ruse made the concession he did at the AAAS meeting. Because he's a philosopher of science, and he knows very well, as I do, that in philosophy of science, to say that there's a group of people, whether it's Darwinian evolutionists or particle physicists or anybody, who just looks at reality direct and has a clear-headed perception of things and doesn't make philosophical assumptions or debatable or have a debatable political agendas even, is very naive. So it's those tensions within the dominant paradigm that seem to me to be creating a situation that calls out for a better view of rationality. So it wasn't quite as simple a question as you may have thought to answer.
Yes, I'd like to switch to biology and paleontology, if I might, for a minute. I just recently finished reading Stephen Jay Gould's wonderful life and his study of the Burgess Shale and the fossils and what that revealed. And one of the things that seemed to be revealing is that the mass patterns in the macro patterns, rather, in the fossil record appear to be the opposite of the what you'd expect from the Darwinian predictions. And yet he seemed to conclude that book with a metaphysical statement that the Burgess Shale fossils prove that the universe is indifferent to our sufferings and we must find our own way, something to that effect. Would you comment on that?
Yes. As the questioner well knows, speaking about Wonderful Life and the Cambrian fossil record is one of the things I regularly do in my lectures, but I didn't today because I decided to do something a little bit different. But probably many of you are familiar with Stephen Jay Gould's book, Wonderful Life. It's one of the big sellers of science in recent years, and it is quite a good book in its own terms. It describes a group of fossils known as the Burgess Shale, which are remarkably preserved specimens. Even the soft body parts are preserved, so one knows a great deal more about them than just the skeletons. From the rocks of the Cambrian era, which is the time at which all of the invertebrate animal phyla appear suddenly. In the Cambrian rocks, and also the predecessors of vertebrates, and you don't get any new phyla afterwards. So the Cambrian era is dated at around 500 million years ago by the official geological estimates. And you see, before that time, you have basically single-celled creatures. And then there's one or two exceptional groups that are off to the side that don't seem to be related to anything that appear just before the Cambrian. But just to simplify a little bit, in the Cambrian era, all these complex animals appear at the same time and very mysteriously. Richard Dawkins, author of The Blind Watchmaker, says it's as if they appeared with no evolutionary history whatsoever. You see, but of course we know that can't be true, says Dawkins, because you know it's unthinkable. They appear. Now, the fascinating thing is that you have all of these phyla, depending on how you count. There's a dispute about how many separate phyla there are, but at least a couple of dozen that are there at the beginning. And all of the change that has happened since then has been within those basic divisions. The phyla, for any of those who don't know what a phylum is, that's the basic division of the animal kingdom. They're the biggest division. So we're within the vertebrate subphylum, you see, of the chordate phylum, that's the basic body plan that we belong in. Now, so all of these basic divisions appear suddenly and at the start, and then the change that occurs thereafter is that new things appear in the rocks after that weren't there before, as far as the rocks record, but that they're within those existing body plans. You don't get any new basic body plans thereafter. And in fact, some of the phyla go extinct, so that we have a lot fewer phyla today than existed then. So that the way that the picture of life runs in the animal kingdom is that you have the greatest amount of disparity, the greatest number of basic divisions at the beginning. And then while there's more variation within those divisions, it's actually narrowing in terms of the big picture. Now, the Darwinian theory predicts the opposite of this. As Gould says in Wonderful Life, it predicts, instead of having all of these divisions at the first and then a narrowing, you know, like this, it predicts that you would start with one creature and that it would diversify. See, first you have one species, then you have two, and then maybe four, and then finally you get enough species that you can divide them into genera, each genus, two genera or more or whatever, and then you get families and classes and finally phyla. So you see there should be a whole cone of increasing diversity, as he calls it, from the point at the beginning, the first species, more and more diversity all the time. And the closer you get to the present, the more of this there should be, the more phyla should be appearing. You see, instead, they're all there at the beginning of animal life, and it's like the Darwinian picture turned upside down. And they're not connected by any of the kind of intermediate transitions or whatever. The phyla are always separate all the way they go back in the rocks. It's about as inconsistent with the Darwinian picture as you could imagine. Well, Gould describes this. He describes it very honestly. And he even says the following, which is the most fascinating. He says there are two theories to explain the appearance of the phyla. One is the artifact theory of the fossil record. Now, this theory says that there were lots of pre-existing fossils recording a step-by-step Darwinian, series down to that first basic one that started, but they've all disappeared for some reason. So the fossil record we have is an artifact. It's not the true fossil record. Somehow, all of this disappeared. Well, then Gould says, but the artifact theory isn't tenable anymore. It looks like it's not true. It looks like there never were any of these transitionals, or this pre-existing evolutionary story. And then he adds, as he always does, a sort of a qualification that you have to try to figure out, at least that can easily be identified. So he said, well, maybe there weren't any. Well, of course, if there weren't any predecessors, connecting these animal phyla with simpler forms of life before then, there's no record of evolution. He just tosses this off and says, well, this is such a crazy, irrational picture of how evolution that occurred, that it shows we're nothing special, and that we're the creatures of a purposeless universe in which we have to make up whatever life plan or purpose we have for us. Now, of course, it doesn't show that at all. To anyone that looked at this with theistic eyes, they would say, well, these fossils do not record anything like the Darwinian picture of evolution, or really any other picture of evolution that anyone can put any content into. It's a totally mysterious thing. It looks like there must be some force outside of science that has produced all of this, and that's, of course, where the purpose would come from. So Gould's philosophical remarks don't really have anything to do with the evidence that he's describing. They're really against that, and they come, of course, from his basic philosophical starting point. Next question.
Stephen Jay Gould has said that the two key features of the fossil evidence are sudden appearance and stasis. And it seems to me that over the past 20 years or so in the creation and evolution debate, both evolutionists and creationists have been focusing on sudden appearance and trying to explain that, explain origins, rather than the pervasive pattern of natural history, and that is stasis. I was just wondering if in your talks with biologists, if they have come up with any either genetic or developmental or ecological mechanisms which may account for stasis. Do you think natural selection could account for the fact that major evolutionary change does not seem to occur in the fossil evidence? And two, does speciation prevent major evolutionary change as a result of saltation?
Yeah. Well, I think that it's greed. I mean that everybody that's writing about the fossil record now agrees that there is a prevailing pattern of stasis. That is to say, once things are in existence, they tend to stay more or less the same until they become extinct or until the present day if they're still around. There may be variation, and that is to say there's no change at all, but that there isn't change of a fundamental or directional nature. That things that the variation is within the type and back and forth or of limited a nature, and that the pattern is this fundamental stability to things. There's no doubt, and I think it's perfectly orthodox to say that one of the major things that produces this stability is natural selection. Because if things should happen to mutate or change, the likelihood is that this will make them less able to survive, because almost all observable mutations are harmful. And so natural selection tends to weed out mutants and tends to keep things within pretty much as they are. And there may well be other mechanisms of stasis as well. But the problem is that, from the evolutionary biologist standpoint, that explaining that things in terms of stasis isn't terribly rewarding. Because while you can do it, and in fact it is done all the time, another thing that is said is that there are developmental constraints. Only certain types of change are possible within the basic body plan that the animal has. Or most kinds of change would make it out of sync with something else that natural selection would eliminate. So in a way, it's back to the problem of natural selection. But that's just explaining how things stay the same is not what evolutionary biologists have wanted to do. What they have wanted to do is to explain how things come into existence, to tell the creation story for the culture, as it were. And so the emphasis has been to say that, well, the way that stasis is interpreted is that it means that the change must occur, when it does occur, sufficiently rapidly and perhaps in sufficiently small populations that it doesn't get recorded. You never see it happening. You just see that there's one thing here and then there's something somewhat different over there. And so there must be a process of change that must have happened somehow that just didn't get recorded. And so, in a way, it's a very unempirical kind of interest, because what is seen, the stasis, is ignored. And for a long time, it couldn't even be reported in scientific journals because it was thought to be of low interest. And what is hypothesized is the invisible process of change and development, because that's what the culture wants. That's what, you know, what people want to provide. So when Stephen Jay Gould and Niles Eldridge proposed the theory of punctuated equilibrium that many of you have heard of, they both explained, very frankly, that what necessitated that theory was that it made it possible to report the prevailing fact of stasis in the fossil record, which had previously been regarded as not worth reporting in scientific journals because it was just non-evidence of evolution, and who cares about that? So after the theory of punctuated equilibrium, it could be reported as support for the theory that evolution occurs in bursts of change in small populations, and that's why you never see it. Now, to my way of thinking, of course, the interesting thing that the punctuated equilibrium controversy brought out was the problem rather than the particular solution that they proposed. Yeah.
I was hoping you could comment on some of the evolution in the thinking, the naturalist assumptions, the metaphysical assumptions of physicists. There was a lecture by David Bohm a couple years ago in which he was describing some of his preliminary work, trying to explain why the postulates of quantum mechanics are as they are. And he was starting to talk about things like an ether, a consciousness net of information, starting to speculate about perhaps consciousness flowed from that kind of thing rather than from chemical interactions. And it seemed to me that some of the foundational basis of physics was starting to shift, you know, still following their type of view of how you do science, but that it itself was evolving.
Well, I think it is, and I think it probably will continue to. I'm not, of course, familiar with the lecture by Bohm that you've mentioned. I know he's one of the most thoughtful and philosophically sophisticated of the theoretical physicists recently deceased, I believe. There always is a change in methods or a kind of the change of approach. After all, after you got quantum mechanics and the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, then very different way of thinking about the ultimate basis of things came around, and I'm sure that will continue. But the more basic question on which there tends to be a stability is this, that the most, you might say, aggressive or visionary individuals in the scientific world, and a lot of them, many of the most brilliant people, hold to a tremendous dream that essentially everything that is of interest or that is worthy of being called real can be explained by their methods. So that the way in which you explain, let's say, the life processes or consciousness might change. But what is unacceptable is to suggest that, well, perhaps there is no explanation of consciousness in terms of solely materialistic factors. You see, that would imply something that reductionist scientists call vitalism. If the life processes, if life, for example, has something involved in it, some spirit, some intelligence, or whatever, that is not fully understandable in terms of physics and chemistry, then that means a mysterious something which is outside the ken of science altogether. And that means inherent limitations on the scientific project. And that means an opening to somebody else to come in and take some of that cultural authority. Suppose, for example, that consciousness cannot be explained by naturalistic reductionist science. Well, then that opens the way for somebody else to come forward and say, we metaphysicians, we religious leaders, we whoever, are going to explain consciousness. And when we've explained consciousness, you know what we've explained? We've explained science, which is a branch of consciousness. So you see, now we become more fundamental than science. And that is, you know, a matter of great concern to somebody who is dreaming of a final theory of physical science, which will explain everything. So it's the ambition, which I think is the crucial thing, rather than the particular kind of explanation. Yeah.
One observable thing that's been given as an example of a positive mutation selection has been the development of bacterial resistance to drugs. How do you explain that in terms of your views on what, mm-hmm. how things have evolved and changed?
Yes, well, of course, it isn't necessary to my view that there be no such thing as a positive, you know, or a beneficial mutation. However, in the example that you think, I know that this is not a matter in which I have a strong personal opinion because it's not my, you know, I'm not a professional researcher in genetics. But I know that some who are feel that mutation is not necessarily the explanation for the ability of, it is random mutation, for the ability of bacteria to develop resistance to certain medicines or whatever, or of insects to pesticides, because they seem to have a capacity to do this with various sorts of things that, you know, may not be due to some chance mechanism at all, but rather to some not yet fully understood capacity of the genome. The famous experiment of a couple of years ago by a scientist named John Cairns, that's been the subject of enormous interest in the scientific community, shows that some bacteria seem to have an ability, one way they put it is to summon mutations, that is to change their genetic composition to meet environmental needs. And this is of conceivably enormous theoretical importance. That is, as I say, it's not a random change that's occurring. It's something that's directed. It suggests echoes of the old Lamarckian notion that the animal could bring about the mutations that it's needed. Well, the evaluation of that is still very far from a complete. But as I say, I would say that the explanation, the most likely explanation, is that bacterial genomes and insect genomes have certain capacities that we don't fully understand to modify themselves in a protective way, and this is one of the things that makes them so formidable in overcoming life's obstacles and not becoming extinct. But maybe it is a random process that generates these things with the vast numbers involved. It's still not a very significant step along the way to proving that a process of that kind is what changed a bacterium into a complex animal. That requires a vast number of exactly the right kind of constructive mutations to arrive when and as they're needed, to be preserved by selection. There's a whole number of theoretical objections to that scenario. And of course, as we've seen, it isn't recorded anywhere in the historical record. So there's a lack of evidence of creative mutation of that kind and of that level, whatever may be the answer to, you know, the very limited examples of possibly beneficial mutations that one can cite. We get one on this side, and then I see that another person coming forward.
I wonder if you'd care to comment briefly on the refreshingly humble approach to the reductionist program that Roger Penrose has taken, for example, in his recent popular book, The Emperor's New Mind.
I'm not, actually, to tell you the truth, I know of that book, and I've read reviews of it, but I haven't read the book, so I'd better not to comment on it. I know that he is, as you say, a much, much more modest in evaluating the reductionist program with the mind and in suggesting the tremendous obstacles to it, but I don't believe that he repudiates it. And if, you know, without speaking to that generally, because I don't have the familiarity with his book that I should to answer the question. There is in science, in general, to generalize a little bit in my answer, there are a lot of biologists who don't like the idea that biology can be explained in terms of physics and chemistry. Two of them are Ernst Mayr and Stephen Jay Gould, two of the most formidable figures in Neo-Darwinism. Gould writes very strongly anti-reductionist things. There are a lot of people who don't like the reductionist theories in the mind. They're all, you know, who cite objections. Now, those people tend to be somewhat half-hearted in their opposition, though. That's certainly true of the biologists that I'm mentioning, because of the problem that they have to, at all costs, avoid vitalism if they don't want to be ridiculed within the world of science. That is to say, it's one thing to suggest that there are all these difficulties in developing a reductionist theory of the mind, or a physical and chemical theory of the biological cell. To say that it's impossible in principle, you see, is to say that there is some additional element in there of a non-physical, non-chemical nature. And that makes you a vitalist. And then you'd better run for cover, because that is almost as reprehensible as outright creationism in the, you know, stable of scientific prejudices. So that's why those tend to be half-hearted. And I don't know if that's, I suspect that might possibly be the case of Penrose, but I don't know, because I'm not well enough, I haven't gotten around to reading his book, which I understand is excellent. It's on my, you know, I mean to, but thank you, yeah.
In regards to your last point on the scientific community imposing naturalistic materialism on society, I was wondering how you reconcile the ending paragraph of Darwin's work of 1859 acknowledging creator capitalized,
mm-hmm.
and how you would attempt in society today, as we tend to be moving towards some sort of paradigm shift, obviously, how would you attempt to reconcile a legalistic separation of church and state and the apparent confusion that Darwin showed in his work, but that some of his supporters like Huxley and Dawkins seem to accentuate.
Those are two very good questions. I'll take up both. First, the concluding quote from Darwin's book. I don't have it in front of me, but it refers to a creator having breathed life into perhaps one form or a few, and thereafter there's grandeur in this process of life that says it was natural selection. Thereafter, it's to that effect. That's what you're referring to. With respect to Darwin's own views with respect to the creator, this is now very well documented. There's a huge Darwin industry of a biography and so on. And I think the simplest answer to give about Darwin's views is that throughout his adult life, he was moving from a position essentially of, first as a very young man, a kind of half-hearted, unthinking, you know, half acceptance of Anglican orthodoxy, then from deism to agnosticism. At times toyed with the idea of the kind of, you know, God who winds the thing up and then lets it go. But by the end of his life was a confirmed agnostic. He very explicitly rejected Christianity as barbaric and horrible because he thought that his father, who was an unbeliever, would be in hell if it were true, and that would be unsupportable. And he also had an experience with a daughter who died. And so, anyway, for various reasons, he became very strongly anti-Christian and agnostic. So any words that he used of a kind of a vaguely theistic kind and phrases which are sprinkled throughout The Origin of Species can best be understood as in two ways. First, he consistently tried to use a rhetoric which would allow his theory to have the broadest possible appeal. He was not interested in provoking a battle with the clergy, but in avoiding it if he could. And second, his wife was quite devout. He didn't want to shock her. You know, his wife took out of his autobiography the passage in which he explained why he had formerly repudiated Christianity. Einstein is another scientist who often talked about God. You know, God does not play dice and so on. But you should not assume that Einstein meant what preachers mean when they talk about God. He did not mean a supernatural being outside of nature. He meant the underlying rationality of the laws of nature themselves. Or Stephen Hawking refers to knowing the mind of God. I've heard ministers cite that as a sort of a biblical Christian, you know, shows these scientists are Christian too. Big mistake. That's not what he means. The fact that a certain amount of God talk is sprinkled in a book doesn't mean that they're really thinking of a position that I'd call theistic realism, you know, of a God who exists as a being outside of a nature. Now, the second question that you asked was about the separation of church and state for legal purposes and sort of what can be done about the situation I've described in the light of that problem. Is that what you were asking? I think this is something that is going to have to be rethought and reformulated in the coming years and is being rethought and reformulated by the courts. In a recent lecture tour that I made in the spring vacation week at the end of March, I gave lectures at three law schools, University of Oklahoma, Southern Methodist University, and the University of Texas, as well as talks at the science departments at those schools. And the subject of my law school lectures was, is God unconstitutional? And I was really responding, you know, I have heard suggestions, including from prominent scholars in the Christian world, from a scholar at a conservative a Christian seminary, I won't say more for identification, who said that, well, this guy Johnson, he says that scientists should consider the possibility that there is a purposeful intelligence behind life. But they can't do that because they get their money from the government. And so it would violate the separation of church and state if they were to consider that possibility. Now, you know, as I say, you can imagine what the atheists are saying. If that's what professor at a conservative Christian seminary is saying. So the idea that God is unconstitutional is very widespread. Now, this, it seems to me, is bizarre. It suggests that in other countries of the world, scientists are free to consider all the possibilities that the evidence suggests, but that here we have this totalitarian ideology which says, you know, that certain things are off limits. We've had cases in the courts where the courts have suggested that it may be unconstitutional for a professor to tell his class that he's a Christian, although he could tell them that he's an atheist, you see, because that's respectable. That to say that God is dead is philosophy, to say that purposeless material forces created everything is science, but to say, well, maybe that's not all true, is to introduce the new subject of religion, which is forbidden. Now, this is crazy. What has happened is that a constitutional provision which was passed to guarantee freedom of thought in this area and to prevent a particular viewpoint from becoming established as the official doctrine of the state and enforced with the power of the state has been utilized for the exact opposite purpose, to impose an ideological straitjacket, to say that certain thoughts may not be thought, that there are thought crimes, that there are speech crimes, and to try to find out the truth about these matters is forbidden. Now, I don't think the Supreme Court ever meant to get there, and I think they're just now realizing, you know, the implications that have been made out of some of their positions, but I'm sure that as we get to, you know, this issue properly put to the courts, they're going to say that freedom of thought rather than a philosophical straitjacket should govern this subject as others. But it might take some education. Yeah.
I really have to object to that point of view because I think it's the peer review process that primarily determines.
Oh, yes.
That determines that rather than government policy.
Oh, yes. You're not objecting. I was answering the question.
To say that God is unconstitutional is rather excessive, I think.
That's my point.
I didn't take it that way, and I think that it's very important to point out to the audience that it's not the government policy. It's rather the peer review process that determines what ideas ultimately make it into the
literature. Well, of course, and the peer review process is full of similar prejudices and political inclinations and so on as well. Now, you know, one of the things. Look, I am now involved in a case involving a senior science professor at a state institution in this state, San Francisco State University, who has told his class that that polls indicate that a very large proportion of the American public does not believe in the fully naturalistic theory of evolution, you know, which is to be taught as unchallengeable truth. And worse, he's told his class that these people have good reason for their doubts, because the theories, particularly of chemical evolution, you know, the ultimate origin of life, are very insecure and unconvincing. And, you know, it's perfectly rational to believe that things couldn't have happened that way and that a purposeful creator was necessary to get life started. That professor has been ordered by the dean never to say anything like that again in a class. That is a heresy which may not be articulated. Now, a similar case occurred at the University of Alabama. And in that case, the dean went to the general counsel of the university and was advised by the general counsel that the dean had a duty to silence the professor because otherwise, the professor was violating the First Amendment, the separation of church and state. And so the dean had a duty to prevent that from being said in class. That view is widely held in certain segments of the legal profession and of the, you know, academic profession in general. So in saying that a number of people have that mistaken, you know, my belief, very dangerous and erroneous idea, I wasn't just making it up. I've actually seen examples of that in application. But nonetheless, I agree with your point that the most important influence in the university is peer pressure, you know, of various kinds, including the peer review process for publication. So it's certainly the case that if you try to challenge a paradigm that is vigorously and, you know, defended by adherence to that paradigm, you're going to have a lot of trouble getting it through the peer review process. Now, that's true with things that are of less cosmic significance than biological evolution. It's reported all the time. There's a whole literature on this. And in fact, there's a Supreme Court case about that right now. It's a case involving the a drug, Bendectin, which was given for morning sickness in pregnancy, and it led, the short of it is it led to a lot of lawsuits that it was causing birth defects. And almost all of the scientific research concluded that it was innocent, that it wasn't causing these defects. One researcher wanted to testify that if you did the studies in a certain way and reevaluated them, it was responsible for birth defects. Of course, the plaintiff's lawyer wanted to put that in evidence. And the lower federal court said you couldn't put that in evidence because it was based on a theory that had not been published in journals and had not gone through peer review. Now, the Supreme Court has granted cert to determine whether, you know, this is an appropriate standard for evaluating the admissibility of purportedly scientific evidence in a court of law. And a number of scientists have filed amicus curiae briefs, friend of the court to tell the judges how to decide the case on both sides. And my old adversary, Stephen Jay Gould, is one of them. And he has filed a brief saying that, science is so full of prejudices and the peer review process is always preventing new ideas that it just enforces an orthodoxy in science, and you shouldn't require it as a filter before you allow the evidence into court. So, among the scientists, there's a vast dispute over whether the peer review process is, to what extent it guarantees quality and to what extent it rules out dissent and innovation.
My point was only that it's not the government that's directly...
Well, as I say, I think the peer pressure and the peer review process is more important. But I'm telling you that there is a view of constitutional law in here. I'm telling you that of which I have direct experience and knowledge, that in fact there is a widespread belief that if in a state university classroom, maybe here, maybe by the way in an after-hours session on university property, if I say God is dead, that's okay. You know, if I say God never did any creating because God doesn't exist, that's okay. But if I say, well, maybe that's not true and maybe, you know, God did the creating, I've suddenly violated the separation of church and state. So that what the principle means in that view, which in my view is erroneous and a wrong-headed view, but widely held, is that it's not that you keep the subject out of the curriculum. It's that you allow only one point of view on the subject to be articulated and ban the other point of view. So I assure you that kind of thing really does go on, although I also agree that the peer pressure and peer review process is much more powerful in terms of its practical effect. But of course that sometimes has assumptions about what the law is as part of its motivation. So do we have any more, or should we, I think maybe it's time to send everybody off to the beach, and thanks very much for coming.